Ah, buonasera a tutti, siamo pronti a cominciare? Buonasera, benvenuti. Siamo in una nuova e speciale location questa sera, avete visto? E benvenuti dunque a Segnavie, orientarsi nel mondo che cambia, il ciclo di conferenze organizzato dalla Fondazione Cassa di Risparmio di Padova e Rovigo. A passo un attimo qui, solo perché entra il microfono, scusate perché sentivo. Bene, di cosa parleremo questa sera? Qual è il tema? Disparità delle opportunità e disuguaglianza del reddito, in che rapporto stanno con l'economia? Quindi una serata speciale questa sera. Come sempre, invito sul palco, prima di cominciare, il presidente della Fondazione Cassa di Risparmio di Padova e Rovigo, Antonio Finotti. Buonasera, presidente.
Grazie, dottoressa. Grazie infinite, buonasera a tutti. Un saluto cordiale a nome della Fondazione Cassa di Risparmio di Padova e Rovigo e un grazie vivissimo per la vostra presenza così numerosa questa sera. È davvero piacere e un onore avere con noi stasera un economista di fama internazionale come il professor François Bourguignon, che ringrazio vivamente per aver accolto il nostro invito. Professor Bourguignon vive in Francia e il nostro pensiero non può non andare ai tragici fatti di Parigi e del Mali per esprimere la nostra vicinanza al professore e a tutto il popolo francese. Vi pregherei di qualche momento di raccoglimento.
Ci alziamo in piedi per qualche secondo dedicato alle vittime di Parigi.
Di nuovo grazie a tutti voi. Ringrazio nuovamente il professor Bourguignon, appunto, di aver voluto essere con noi stasera. Ringrazio anche il dottor Dario Di Vico, giornalista esperto di temi economici, che abbiamo già avuto modo di conoscere e apprezzare in occasione dei precedenti incontri con Alberto Alesina nel primo anno del nostro Segnavie e successivamente con Zygmunt Bauman. Il ciclo di conferenze Segnavie fa tappa oggi per la prima volta in questo auditorium allestito e collocato all'interno del più antico orto botanico universitario del mondo, un vero e proprio fiore all'occhiello della nostra città. Ringrazio il magnifico rettore che ci ha dato questa onore, ci ha fatto questa concessione e quindi ci ha concesso questo onore questa sera. Ci troviamo perciò in una location prestigiosa e importante, così come importante e attuale il tema del quale parleremo tra poco. Di disuguaglianza si dibatte ormai da molti anni. Le disparità economiche e di opportunità sono in effetti particolarmente diffuse nella nostra società e generano spesso povertà e nei casi più estremi sono terreno fertile di violenza. Povertà legate anche alla mancanza di lavoro, a situazioni di emarginazione o di disagio, ambiti su cui il nostro ente, come è noto, è molto attivo. Nel tentativo di dare risposte mirate ai diversi bisogni delle persone più svantaggiate. Ma è più dannosa la disparità di redditi o quella delle opportunità? E come è possibile operare con efficacia su entrambi i fronti, ammesso che si ritenga opportuno farlo? Sono solo alcune delle domande a cui si cercherà di dare una risposta stasera, con la consapevolezza, tuttavia, che non esistono soluzioni immediate e a portata di mano. Non a caso, nel titolo dell'incontro abbiamo inserito il termine dilemma utilizzando un'espressione che secondo noi si presta a rendere bene la complessità del tema, un po' come è successo nell'ultimo incontro di Segnavie, quando abbiamo riflettuto sul dilemma tra conservazione e valorizzazione del patrimonio culturale. Allora erano emersi accanto alla differenza di opinioni anche punti di contatto tra i sostenitori dell'una o dell'altra posizione, con un dibattito vivace e ricco di spunti. Ci auguriamo quindi che questa sera possa accadere quello che abbiamo potuto constatare con piacere l'ultima volta che ci siamo incontrati. Vi rinnovo il grazie per la vostra presenza e vi auguro buon ascolto.
Grazie Presidente. Grazie. Presentiamo allora i relatori di questa sera. Mi lascia il microfono, Presidente, vengo a riprenderlo, così è a disposizione. Grazie. Per i relatori. Scusate, faccio un paio di... sistemo questa perché ho staccato la... avviso che ho staccato il come si dice, il cursore, no? Vabbè, insomma, solo perché dopo non, magari non sente. Ok, relatori di questa sera, François Bourguignon, professore di economia, è stato direttore alla Paris School of Economics fino al 2013 e ha insegnato all'École des Hautes Études en Sciences Sociales di Parigi. È un esperto in economia politica, distribuzione del reddito, disuguaglianza e sviluppo economico. Ha pubblicato numerosi saggi accademici e libri, tra cui La globalizzazione della disuguaglianza. È stato capo economista alla Banca Mondiale dal 2003 al 2007. È attivo nelle community di sviluppo internazionale come relatore consulente di governi e delle principali agenzie internazionali. Monsieur François Bourguignon, buonasera, benvenuto. Prego. Dario Di Vico è già un amico di Segnavie, l'abbiamo appunto già incontrato nelle conferenze con Alberto Alesina e con il professor Baumann, è laureato in sociologia a Roma, lavora al Corriere della Sera dal 1989 e ne è stato vice direttore per 5 anni. Oggi è editorialista inviato e si occupa prevalentemente di lavoro, industria ed economia reale. Dario Di Vico, buonasera e benvenuto. Come sempre vi ricordo che siamo attivi sui social, quindi se volete connettere i vostri smartphone potete accedere con Ortobotanico Guest, questa è la rete Wi-Fi, la password è Open Week, potrete seguirci naturalmente sulla pagina Facebook Segnavie, potete twittare con l'hashtag Segnavie perché siamo come sempre attivi con il nostro live tweeting. Al termine della conferenza potremo raccogliere le vostre domande che vi chiediamo come sempre siano sintetiche. Grazie e buon lavoro.
Il programma prevede appunto una relazione del professor Bourguignon, però gli devo fare una domanda prima. Intanto perché purtroppo arrivano notizie pessime anche dalla Tunisia oggi e quindi il tema del terrorismo e del rapporto tra terrorismo e condizioni di vita nei paesi arabi è un tema che si impone. Il professor Bourguignon ha scritto di recente sull'Les Echos un articolo proprio intitolato L'économie du terrorisme e l'ho trovato molto interessante, perché lui analizza appunto il nodo che dicevo prima e elabora una definizione, un'interpretazione sul concetto di domanda e offerta applicato appunto al reclutamento dei terroristi da parte delle organizzazioni come l'ISIS. Ci spiega qual è la sua tesi?
Ok, buonasera a tutti. But I believe that I will stop here with Italian. Sorry about this, but you cannot speak too many languages. No, thank you very much for the question. Of course, and thank you very much for the thought that you gave to the events of those recent days in Paris. So this issue of terrorism is a very complicated issue. And in this article, I was trying to summarize what economists have said on this topic about terrorism. And this idea of supply and demand, which is really the basics of economics, all economists talk about supply and demand. I'm not sure that they can think out of that box, but it is a very easy box. And in the case of terrorism, what is most striking is the fact that the demand comes from all those terrorist organizations. They are asking for fighters, and we might call them suicide bombers rather than fighters. And what is quite amazing is the fact that there is a huge supply of people willing to give up their life in order to contribute to the cause of those terrorist organizations, and of course to the cause that is that they are defending. And this is somewhat surprising, but in this article I'm explaining that those organizations have so many candidates for terrorism that they are selecting them. And you almost have a test to decide who is the right person and who is not the right person. And from that point of view, we could think that one way of fighting terrorism would be to reduce the supply of candidates. But then when we go to see where those candidates are coming from, it would be very tempting, as the president said, to believe that those people are coming from poor backgrounds, poor neighborhoods, that they are a little educated, they have really religion as the only kind of way of thinking. But this is not true. A study which was made by American colleagues a long time ago about Palestinian suicide bombers showed that those people were in general educated. They were coming from middle-income families. And it was not at all the case that by generating development in those poor neighborhoods in Palestine, we would be eliminating the suicide bombers. We would be eliminating the supply. So it is something which is different and which we don't understand very well. And if you have read some books about the history of some terrorists, then there is this book by this Egyptian novelist about the transformation of a student in the university into a suicide bomber, which is quite impressive, because you understand that the whole issue is an issue with religion, an issue with defining oneself with respect to a world which is changing. And religion is playing a very specific role. And the more I go, the less I believe that terrorism is an economic issue.
Grazie. Passiamo adesso al suo speech e vedremo delle slide che ci aiutano un po' appunto a seguire il ragionamento del professore.
Okay, what I want to talk about is about inequality. Inequality has become a very timely topic. In many countries, including Italy, people, politicians, the political debate is much more than it was the case in the past about inequality. And let me show you a few evidence about the reason why this is the case. Here you have a chart which shows the evolution over the last century of one measure of inequality, which is the share of total market income going to people, which goes to the 5% richest people in the population. And this is for several countries. The data are tax data, so they are quite reliable. And what you can see here is that we have a kind of U curve The top curve is for the United States. So we have a U curve. You have a very high level of inequality, with a share of the richest being very high at the beginning of the 20th century. Then you have a drop taking place with the crisis in the 30s and the war, and then in the 50s with the building of the welfare state. Then you have a plateau. And then in the 80s, more or less starting in the 80s, you have this big increase. And you see that in the United States, inequality today is more or less back to where it was in the beginning of the 20th century. And this is the kind of evidence which triggered the interest today about inequality in the world. And you see that it is the same evolution for the United Kingdom. It is the same evolution for Japan. France is more flatter. I mean, the evolution has not been exactly the same as in other countries. But in a country like Sweden, which is a Nordic country where the philosophy is very egalitarian, we have the same kind of evolution. And even in China, over the recent past, we have the same increase in inequality. Now, this is the inequality in market income. If we want to look at the inequality after taxes, after transfers to the poorest people, the situation is slightly different. Here we have some charts which show the evolution of inequality in various countries after taxes and transfers. This is really disposable income per capita in those various countries. What is the degree of inequality? Here we have the non-EU countries, and you see that in the United States, in Australia, in Canada, in Israel, in Japan, in all those countries, inequality has been increasing over the last 30 years. And here we have the evolution in Europe, and I picked up this chart because in that chart we have the case of Italy. Italy is the green curve, and you have this big increase in inequality in Italy taking place in the 90s, and then you have a plateau and then a small drop that we have here. And this increase in inequality in Italy is paralleled by an increase in the United Kingdom. Here you have Germany here with a big increase. Here you have all the Nordic countries, Sweden, Denmark, Finland, where inequality is increasing. And this is really what, again, triggered the debate these days on inequality. But this debate is somewhat confusing, because when we ask people about what they think about inequality, we realize that the perception of inequality has not very much to do with what statisticians are producing. This is the statistics, official statistics about inequality. But if we ask people, what do you think about inequality? In some countries where inequality is increasing a lot, they will say, no change. And this is the case, for example, in the United States. A poll in the United States about inequality, asking people, what do you think has going on with inequality in the United States over the last 15 years? They will say, nothing. We are in the same rather egalitarian and equitable and fair society. And in the opposite case, you go to Brazil and you ask Brazilians, what do you think about the change in inequality over the last 10 years or 15 years? Then Brazilian will tell you, oh, inequality has exploded. But precisely in one of the most inegalitarian countries in the world, over the last 15 years, we have an historical drop in inequality. And basically because of the policies implemented by Lula and his successor. So what does that mean? What does it mean that people don't think in the same way as available evidence? One possibility, and this is a point I would like to develop here, one possibility that the concept of inequality is not the same in the mind of the people. And what I want to insist upon is the distinction to be made between inequality of income or inequality of outcomes, which outcomes being the result of economic activity. Income is one of the outcomes. We may consider that wealth is another outcome, that consumption expenditures is another outcome, etc. And I want to oppose this concept of inequality of the results of economic activity with another concept of inequality, which is inequality of opportunities. What is the set of possible actions that people may have in order to generate income? It is possible that when I look at two different people, they may have exactly the same background in terms of family, in terms of social neighborhood, in terms of even education. But maybe late in life, I mean, when they are in their 40s, I will observe that one of them has an income much higher than the other. And when I get into the detail of that, I will discover that the first one has worked a lot, or has become an entrepreneur, has taken a lot of risk, and finally was successful and has a high level of income. Whereas the other was not so much interested by this kind of activity, enjoyed life much more, and ends up with a level of income which is at the middle of the distribution. Should we say that those two people are unequal? They have exactly the same background, they have the same possibilities. One decided to earn money, the other one decided to live at a reasonable level of, with a reasonable standard of living. Should we say that those people are unequal? In terms of income, they are unequal. But in terms of opportunities, they are the same. One decided to do something else than the other. And if we believe in freedom, then we should not consider that there is anything wrong with the person who has earned more income than the other. And this opposition between inequality of outcomes, the results, and inequality in the opportunities that people had to start with is the big debate about inequality today. And it's quite possible, coming back to my example with Brazil and United States, it is quite possible when an American is saying, I'm living in a fair society, and I don't care about the level of inequality, I don't care about the Gates, the Zuckerberg, etc., who are extremely rich, because those people had the same opportunities as I had. They simply were brighter, or they had more luck, or they worked much more than I did. And in my society, there is equality. Many Americans would think in that way. So what I want to develop is this dualism between the inequality of income and inequality of opportunities. And the question is, what type of inequality does matter most? One first view, when you look at the philosophers, you have egalitarian philosophers who say the only thing which matters is the result. So I want to look only at incomes, and a good society is a society where there is very little inequality of incomes. So if people are very rich, let's tax them so that we are reducing the disparities in income. So this is one view to inequality. Another view, which is the one I just described, is the liberal view, the liberal moral philosophical view on inequality, which say that only those income differences which come from what individuals are not responsible for matter. The inequality which comes from the choices made by people is not something which must be corrected. This is the choice of those people, and it must be respected. But inequality coming from the fact that this person has been raised in a wealthy family with a lot of social connections when he or she got into the labor market, this kind of inequality is what must be eliminated. And so this is the second view. This is inequality of opportunities. Circumstances which are beyond the control or the responsibility of people, and efforts, which is under the responsibility of the people, and which is their choice. Then there is another view about inequality, which is an economic view, which says inequality is more than a moral position. Inequality may have an impact on the way in which a society and an economy functions. And an economy where there are too many inequality of opportunities will not be able to exploit the talent of all the people. And because of that, we may expect that a country or an economy or society where there is a lot of inequality of opportunities will not function as well as a society where there is less inequality of opportunities. Inequality of opportunities being defined as not everybody can express his or her talent in the same way. This is what is making the economy less efficient. And this is a kind of inequality that must be reduced if we want to make the society more more efficient. And this is that kind of inequality that we have to correct, not the inequality of incomes. And what we hear very often is this policy recommendation: equalize opportunities rather than income. If you do that, you will improve the efficiency, the productivity of your economy, the economy will function better, and at the same time, you will equalize incomes at the end. To make things clear, let me give you a very simple example, which may be coming from the experience I have on development. You are in a country where people have some investment project. One person has a very nice investment project, but is coming from a poor family background and needs money to invest in his project, but there is no money in the family. And when this person goes to see a banker, the banker says, what is your collateral? I don't have any collateral, but I have a fantastic project for investment. And then the banker says, okay, look, I mean, your project may be okay, but as long as you don't have any collateral to guarantee that at the end you will be repaying the loan, I will not lend you any money. Then this project is not undertaken. Another guy in this society has a project which is mediocre. It's a good project, but not fantastic. But this person comes from a wealthy family, has very nice contacts. The banker may be a friend of the family, then if there is not enough money in the family, this person will go to see the banker, and the banker will say, okay, fine, I know your father, I know your parents, I know your cousin, I will give you the loan. At the end of the day, what happens? A project will be undertaken, which is not the best one. A good project will not be undertaken, and a mediocre project will be undertaken. This is typically the kind of inefficiency that is generated by the inequality of opportunities. Think now about education. Think about the fact that in some families, it is costly to send kids to the university, simply because the cost of having the cost of living for the kid is rather high, even when tuition fees are not important. And you have another example, talented students or talented people don't go to the university, whereas less talented people have no problem in going to the university. Another inefficiency. So this is a kind of inefficiency that we can try to correct by looking at inequality of opportunities. And at the end, of course, if we are able to reduce that inequality, the income of the people will be much similar. Now, what I want to show is that this dichotomy between opportunities and income is conceptually correct, but practically it is very difficult to isolate both of them. If we want to equalize opportunities, we have to equalize income. And if we want to prevent opportunities to become too unequal, we need to equalize income. So there is a circle linking opportunities and income. So let me go through these four points very quickly, measuring how can we measure the inequality of opportunity, some evidence on the impact of the inequality of opportunity on economic efficiency. Why is it the case that equalizing opportunities generally requires equalizing incomes? And I will end up with a curve which is becoming quite famous among economists called the Great Gatsby curve. And I let, I don't give an explanation at this stage to have some suspense in this presentation. Okay, measuring the inequality of opportunities, one very simple way is to look at social mobility. Is it the case that people coming from well-to-do families are themselves well-off? Or is it the case that there is a lot of churning when you move from one generation to the next? And we can look at what is the relationship between the income of the parents and the income of the children, more or less at the same age. We can look at the transmission of wealth. We can look at the transmission of education or the transmission of social status. And we can do it in various ways. I don't want to spend too much time on this. Let me simply show you some figures. This is a measure of income immobility rather than income mobility. What this measure, what is here, this is an elasticity which says the following. 0.5 means the following. If the parents get 1% income more, then if the elasticity of the son-father elasticity is 0.5, this means that the son will get 0.5% more. Okay? So it is a transmission of the income capacity, of course, between generations. In that case, we are looking at parents when they are in their 40s, and we are looking at the kids when they are in their 40s. So we are looking at people more or less at the same stage in the life cycle. So we are not looking at kids when they are in their 20s, and their life is not well defined. Now, what you see here is that in for the few countries for which we have this kind of information, there is huge differences. You have the Nordic countries here, where the elasticity is very low. And in the case of Denmark, it's close to zero. There is almost no transmission. I mean, the income of the parents have very, very little impact on the income of the children. And we have the case of the United States, where, unlike what the Americans believe, there is a lot of immobility across generations in the United States. There is certainly much less mobility in the US than in the Nordic countries, and even as in a country like Germany. And then you have the three countries here, France, UK, Italy, which are more or less at the same level, and which are really on the upper side of the whole scale. So we would be Italian, British, and French people would be more on the side of social immobility rather than social mobility. So this shows that there is definitely big differences across country, and what we might try to do is to find policies which will be reducing this the size of this bar and making it more similar to what we observe in the Nordic countries. At the same time, maybe the optimum may not be exactly zero elasticity. Another example is given by this chart here. What we have in this chart is the following. We have many more countries here, and the idea is to look at, when we look at the income of the people, in some household surveys, we observe the characteristics of the parents. Then the idea is to see what is the share of the inequality in income that is explained by the family background of the people. And by looking at that share, we have an idea about the importance of the opportunities, of the inequality of opportunities in shaping the inequality of income. And In that chart, for example, if we look at this country, almost at the end is Brazil. In Brazil, when we look at the characteristics of the parent in terms of education, in terms of occupation, in terms of race or skin color, then we can say that 30% of the observed inequality of income in one generation is due to their parents, to differences in their parents. And again, at the top here, we find the Nordic countries, Norway, Sweden, Poland, and Italy is somewhere here, okay? And France is somewhere there. Again, we are very close to each other. So this shows that certainly this figure here are the kind of underestimation of the role of opportunities. Why? Simply because we are missing some of them. And let me come back to this slide. The problem with social mobility and with intergenerational mobility is that we're only getting one part of the inequality of opportunities. Another part may be due to circumstances which are imposed to people and which are unrelated to parents' characteristics. If you're in a country where there is labor market discrimination, and to start with, let's talk about gender discrimination. This is beyond the responsibility of the people. Fortunately or unfortunately, you don't choose your sex. Then the point I was making before, access to credit. This is the example I was given before. You are in an economy where some people have some monopoly situations and they will get some rents. You are in a country where there is corruption, and because you happen to know the good people or because you happen to have been in the right circle, you have advantages that other people don't have. All these are inequality in circumstances beyond the control of the people and which are determining their income, the way in which they will be able to generate some income, the way in which they will be able to get more or less income, higher or lower standard of living. Now, there is no comprehensive measure of the inequality of opportunity. In the field of income inequality, income is one variable, one quantity. It is not difficult to measure how different quantities among various individuals are. It is much more difficult to do the same thing with combining labor market discrimination, the wealth of the parents, the education of the parents, the race of the people, etc. We cannot aggregate all this into one single coefficient to say there is more, there is less inequality of opportunity in that country. So this is one of the difficulties, that opportunities are difficult to measure. My second point is about the evidence about the impact of the inequality of opportunity about economic efficiency. I already gave the example of credit rationing. You don't have access to credit. In some cases, you have access to credit, or you can undertake an investment in education, or you cannot, depending on the way the collateral that you can show when going to see a banker, or depending on the income and the wealth of the family. We have evidence on labor market discrimination. All this we are able to show, to give evidence that people who are facing different situations in these various dimensions will not perform in the same way. The earnings will not be the same. And from that point of view, we know that there would be a higher level of production or income in the whole economy if we were able to get rid of those inequality of opportunities. Now, what we don't know is how this aggregates at the macro level. It is very difficult to say. If we were able to equalize opportunities, we don't really know what it means exactly, then this economy would be able to grow at a faster rate or would get, would increase or would expand by 15% or by 20%. This is very difficult to say. We have evidence at the micro level that the inequality of opportunities matters. It is another story to measure that. Now, you could try to compare countries. But as I said before, because we don't observe the inequality of opportunity, we cannot measure and compare countries in a very easy way, then it is difficult to get evidence at the aggregate level. Now, what many people do, they have the following argument. They say, okay, true, we cannot measure the inequality of opportunities. But we know that a country where there is a lot of inequality of opportunities is a country where the income will be very unequal. So let's consider the inequality of income as a proxy for the inequality of opportunities. And let's see whether it is okay that countries where the inequality of income is higher are countries which perform not as well as other countries. And there is a huge literature in economics on this, trying to see what is the correlation between income inequality and growth. And there is a very nice study published by the OECD recently, which showed that there is a negative correlation. More inequality of income is generating slower growth in the countries they are analyzing, especially in the group of OECD countries. So this is fine. And the problem is, how should we interpret that evidence? And this is where things are somewhat subtle. People who tend to, egalitarians, who tend to interpret this evidence and say, look, in order for this economy to grow faster, let's equalize incomes. But we don't know what is behind that relationship. Let's say that the problem is that we are in a country where there is a huge inequality in the quality of education. And we know that education, there is not so much inequality in the number of years of schooling of the people, especially in our countries where schooling is compulsory until rather late in the life of the kids. But we know that there is a huge inequality in the quality of schooling. Then let's say that this is this inequality of schooling which is generating less efficiency in the economy because we have many people with a very low skill, and because of that, the economy is not performing very well. At the same time, because there is a lot of inequality in the quality of education, there will be a lot of inequality in income. Then if we look at this and you say that relationship and we say equalize income and the country will do better and the economy will do better, we are making a mistake. What we should do is to equalize the quality of education, in which case at the same time the economy will do better and the income distribution will become more equal. And this is the difficulty, the kind of ambiguity in which we are in the field of inequality in trying to understand the way in which all this works. But to interpret this kind of evidence, statistical evidence, you know that we say that correlation is not causation. This is exactly that. To interpret this as causation would be completely wrong. And again, the argument in terms of inequality of opportunities is probably much stronger. I'm almost done, still two slides. First, okay, let's say that we agree on the fact that opportunities is what matters in the sense that opportunities are at the same time determining the efficiency of the economy, partly the efficiency of the economy, and opportunities are also determining the distribution of income in the economy. Now, because of that, let's say that we want to equalize opportunities. The problem with opportunities, the problem of circumstances, is that we cannot redistribute them as income. Income can be redistributed easily. You tax the rich people and you give the money to poor people. This is simple redistribution. In the field of circumstances, you cannot do that. You cannot take away human capital or education or the skill of some people and to give it to some other people. What you have to do, you have to change the way in which the schooling system is working. You have to make sure that the quality of education is uniform in the society, that there is no suburbs where the schools are crowded and the teachers are in fact of lower quality than in other neighborhoods. Now, if you want to do that, you need money. You need to invest more in the educational system. Now, you may say that there is progress to be made even without more resources, but in general, you will need money. And if you need money, this means that you need to raise that money. And if you want to equalize opportunities, of course, you will intend to raise money in the richer part of the income distribution. This means that in order to equalize opportunities, circumstances, most likely you will need to raise money, and by doing that, you will be redistributing income across in the population. Look at, for example, this kind of measure. You want to equalize opportunities in the educational system. Here I'm using possibly progressive taxation. One thing which has been proposed in many cases is to abolish the free tuition fees in universities. Many countries, including Italy, are such, I mean, not every, I mean, some places are such that there is small tuition fees. In France, we have small tuition fees, small when we compare to what is the case in the United States, where you have to pay $50,000 for 1 year of tuition. Now, one proposal which has been made in many countries is to make university tuition fees not free anymore, and to give scholarships to people who don't have the money to pay for that. This is completely equivalent to redistributing income. This means that people who have the resources to pay for the tuition fees will pay for them. People who don't have this money will not pay for them. The tuition fees will be free for them. This is exactly an income redistribution which goes through some good, which is free for some and not free for others. Now, you can generalize this kind of example to other interventions, more egalitarian distribution of infrastructure, better access to justice. You can talk about the macro. In all those cases, we need resources, and or we need to correct market imperfections which are generating inequality of opportunities. And the point is that in order to equalize opportunities, we need to redistribute income. So the view that we should be operating in one side and not on the other, according to that, is a view which is erroneous. We, in order to equalize opportunities, which is ultimate goal, we need to go through some income distribution, redistribution. Now, the gain from equalizing opportunities may thus be somewhat reduced if we believe that redistributing income has a cost. If there is a limit to the taxation that we can have in any country. We know that increasing taxation will reduce incentives of people to do things, to work, to undertake a new investment, to take risk, to innovate, which means that we don't want to redistribute too much. So we have to take care of the fact that the gain that we may have from equalizing opportunities may be reduced through losses linked to income redistribution. Now, good policies, of course, will yield a social surplus. Now, this argument here simply says that it is not because we believe that the inequality of opportunities is the root of inefficiency and inequality of income that we should only be operating on opportunities. We will not be able to do that without using some income redistribution. And to finish off, we can also look at the reverse causality, which goes from the income distribution to the inequality of opportunities. What I've just said is that if you want to equalize opportunities, you need to redistribute income. But the point is that we also know that if there is too much inequality of income, we will be generating inequality of opportunity. So this is another reason why we want to redistribute income. And this is what has been called by Alan Krueger, when he was the economic advisor of Obama, in some public conference, somebody showed that chart, and he said this is, we could call that chart the Great Gatsby, in the sense that Gatsby in the novel by Fitzgerald is this guy who was able to become extremely rich through possibly corruption, but this was a case of social mobility, and this is the reason why this curve has been termed the Great Gatsby curve. Now, what does it say? On this axis here, you have the income inequality in those various countries. These are more or less the country that we had in the previous chart. And here we have the mobility, or more exactly, the immobility of those countries. This is elasticity that we have seen in the previous chart. And what you observe here is that there is a very clear relationship between those two dimensions. The more unequal a country is, the less mobility there is. So you see that here you have the United States, United Kingdom, Italy, France. We have seen earlier that these were the countries with less social mobility and with the least social mobility. And here we have the Nordic countries where we have a high social mobility and a low level of inequality. So if we are not convinced by the argument in terms of efficiency about redistributing, equalizing opportunities requires redistributing income, here we have a very good case saying it is because we are in unequal societies in terms of income that we are generating social immobility. And let me finish with the following anecdote. When I was in the World Bank, this is really where I tried to introduce this issue about inequality of opportunities. First, I tried to convince people in the bank to talk about inequality, which was not something that was in the current language of the World Bank. And second, we introduced with colleagues this distinction between income and opportunity. I believe that at the end it worked rather well. And in those days, when I was visiting countries, I was having this kind of discourse. And one country where there is some concern about increasing inequality is China. China started as an extremely unequal society at the time of the communist regime. And in 1978, when Deng Xiaoping decided to introduce reforms to make the economy more efficient, because it was a very inefficient economy, basically because nobody had incentives to do well, simply because there was equality everywhere. When this happened, inequality necessarily went up. But the problem is that 40 years later, no, 35 years later, inequality is still going up in China. Whereas we should have expected that once they would be in a market economy, inequality would have stopped down. Then I was telling the Chinese about this kind of curve, telling them, look, what you are doing with this increase in inequality with all those billionaires, with the fact that many people are lagging behind in the Chinese development, you are creating inequality which will be transmitted to the future generations. And you might become a Latin American country where inequality is extremely high because since the conquista, a couple of families have transmitted the wealth that they got from the conquista. And the Chinese were indeed quite convinced that this was a problem. And the only question was, could you tell us at what level of inequality of income things will become dangerous so that we will be taking some measures to prevent inequality to go beyond that level. Unfortunately, economics is not really a science, and it is completely impossible to give such a precise answer to this kind of question. But this simply shows that this is an issue of concern, and this distinction between inequality of opportunity and inequality of income is a very important conceptual issue, but we have to deal with them in a unified way, which is under the heading of inequality and no other qualification. And I stop here. Thank you very much.
Allora, la relazione del professore è stata molto densa, no? Diciamo tantissimi concetti uno dietro l'altro, quindi l'errore che il moderatore può fare è tentare di riassumerla. Io non farò questo errore e mi limiterò, come dire, ad estrarre qualcosa che mi ha più colpito e poi arrivare alle domande. Sicuramente è molto interessante la tenete presente che se voi andate in libreria, io ho fatto, venendo in treno, sono andato nella libreria Feltrinelli della stazione di Milano, nel reparto della saggistica il tema della disuguaglianza è il tema che... Secondo, solo. Dicevo che sono andando in una libreria nel reparto saggistica, ovviamente, e i titoli sulla disuguaglianza sono moltissimi, no? L'ho potuto constatare poche ore fa e quindi sono anche molto differenti le interpretazioni. Qui il professor Bourguignon ci ha dato un'interpretazione molto netta, molto significativa, anche relativamente controcorrente rispetto al dibattito di oggi e anche, diciamo, alla sua semplificazione. Dicevo che non farò l'errore di tentare di riassumere una relazione così densa. Estrarrò solo alcune cose che hanno colpito mi hanno colpito maggiormente e poi passerò alle domande. È interessante per esempio questo discorso, cioè mentre preso il livello globale la disuguaglianza è diminuita, immaginate solo il peso dei numeri cinesi in questa discussione. Nei paesi dell'Occidente, del primo mondo, il livello della disuguaglianza è cresciuta ed è cresciuto ancora di più, aggiungo io, la percezione che la disuguaglianza sia cresciuta. Cioè noi dobbiamo tenere presenti anche questi due elementi, il livello oggettivo e il livello percettivo. Il livello percettivo è molto superiore, tant'è vero che noi sentiamo anche delle semplificazioni del tipo che la crisi è nata dalla disuguaglianza. No, proprio perché la percezione è così netta. Però dobbiamo tenere presente appunto il piano globale e il piano dell'Occidente e anche dei singoli paesi, ovviamente il nostro. È interessantissima poi la questione, diciamo, il rapporto tra disuguaglianza e funzionamento dell'economia. Non è automatico che la disuguaglianza porti un appiattimento dell'economia, dipende dai cicli economici. Una disuguaglianza caratterizzata da una forte mobilità sociale può anche, come dire, far aumentare di molto il PIL, magari, come dire, distanziando i vagoni, ma sempre facendoli correre. E questo è un elemento molto importante. È chiaro che noi siamo in una fase, poi domanderò questo, del tutto particolare, perché questa crisi che noi abbiamo avuto non è stata una delle classiche crisi cicliche, e appunto chiederò al professore come una crisi così lunga abbia messo in discussione questi meccanismi. Non vi prendo altro tempo, no, interessante la sottolineatura sugli Stati Uniti, no? Noi siamo abituati, Stati Uniti e mobilità sociale, il sogno americano, gli Stati Uniti come metafora della mobilità sociale, invece qualche dato che il professore ci ha segnalato non certifica questa nostra percezione. Arrivo un po' a una serie di domande, una per una ovviamente. La questione lei insiste molto sul fatto che quindi non è la disuguaglianza del reddito che noi dobbiamo guardare, la disuguaglianza delle opportunità. Diciamo con una semplificazione forte, mi viene da dire che quindi uscendo dalla crisi noi dobbiamo stare attenti più alla distanza che si crea tra le generazioni più che dalla distanza che si crea dentro le classi di reddito. Vi faccio un esempio della cronaca di questi giorni. Si sta parlando del rinnovo dei contratti di lavoro. In alcune categorie gli imprenditori si sono seduti al tavolo dicendo, a mo' di provocazione, che i lavoratori dovevano ridare indietro i soldi, nel senso che il meccanismo dell'inflazione programmata che era stato adottato, in realtà con l'inflazione bassissima che c'è stata, ha, come dire, garantito di più i redditi di lavoro. Ma per i giovani? Ecco, allora, noi dobbiamo spostare, perché la nostra discussione è più sul fatto che ci sono le disuguaglianze di reddito tra le classi, mentre, come dire, verrebbe da dire, seguendo la sua impostazione, che i veri sconfitti della crisi sono i giovani, o meglio, diciamo, sconfitti, quelli che pagano un prezzo enormemente superiore ai loro padri. È corretto dire così?
Okay, thank you very much for this point. Okay, on your first point about perception and the difference between subjective and objective, I think that you are absolutely right. And the example that I gave, the examples I gave at the beginning of my talk, is really a confirmation of that. There is possibly some divergence between subjective perception of inequality and the actual level of inequality. Except for the fact, as I said, inequality is somehow a fuzzy concept because it does not represent the same thing among people. For example, it is quite interesting to see that when you ask people about how much different occupations are earning, how much a doctor is making, how much a worker, unskilled worker is making, etc., how much a teacher is earning, then people have relatively good view about this. Nevertheless, their evaluation, subject evaluation of inequality and the change in inequality may be contrary to the evidence. So there is something else in the way in which inequality is being felt that does not fit the statistics which may be very much influenced by the media. It may be sufficient to have some big propaganda in the media around somebody who is earning a huge amount of money for people to believe that up there in a world they have no idea about, there are people who are earning a huge amount of money. Is it what is going on? It's not clear. But this is not something which belongs to economics, although economics is getting into behavior and perception and is getting closer and closer to psychology. But there is something to be understood there. And for the moment, I must say that this is not something which is clear in my mind. We also have to remember that inequality is a very convenient topic for politicians. And when we are in electoral times in a country, and when we hear every day and several times a day politicians talking about inequality, even though even the politicians don't realize really what is going on, then you may understand that finally people have a view about inequality which is not completely which does not fit the objective level of inequality. So, true, this is something that we have to understand. This is the way in which perceptions are being formed. This is a psychology of the mass. And this is a topic per se, but I completely agree with this. Then on your second point, would you mind maybe summarizing it? Because I'm not sure I got it completely. Could you summarize it in a few words?
A causa della bassa inflazione, okay. Le organizzazioni imprenditoriali hanno sostenuto che i redditi dei lavoratori dipendenti sono stati non solo protetti, ma si sono giovati di un'inflazione programmata che era superiore. Allora, riferivo solo questo episodio per dire come in realtà, seguendo la sua impostazione, non era tanto il reddito tra le classi l'elemento di maggior novità negativa causato dalla crisi, ma quanto il rapporto con le chance dei giovani, e quindi i giovani come i veri sconfitti.
Ok. Okay. I was not referring to that part of your question, but to the intermediate one. But okay, let me answer this one. Yes, I mean, it is completely clear that there is, in our societies today, there is an inequality across generations, which is quite serious. And one aspect of it is the fact that parents today know that their children will not necessarily be doing better than they did. In the old days, there was a view that the next generation would make progress with respect to the elder generation. Today, this is not true anymore. And it is certainly the case that if we were to look at the current youth generation in 10 or 15 or 20 year time, that we'll find that there is a huge inequality between the way in which that generation has fared in comparison with the parents. I'm not sure this is an issue of inflation. I think it is really an issue of economic growth. Baby boomers have been living in a very nice world, where, especially in Europe, growth was very, very fast. Many things were going on. A lot of modernization was taking place. There was this catching up of Europe with respect to the United States. We had those brilliant years after the war and until more or less the oil price boom in the 70s. And this meant that those people did very well. Now, how should we consider the impact in terms of inequality, the impact of crisis, and the fact that the crisis, it's not only the crisis, I mean, the fact that growth has slowed down, which is a kind of penalty for the young generations. How do we interpret that? I'm not clear. I mean, probably the baby boomers, our generation to some extent, has been extremely lucky. When you look at history, the rate of growth of all our economies has been more or less the one that we observe today, 1.5%, between 1.5% per capita. It has been like that for a very long time. The exception is the post-war period. And there you had a generation which was extremely lucky. And that generation built a social system which was based on this idea that this growth rate, which was very high, would continue. When I was a kid, I remember my father telling me, no problem, next year we will have 4% more than this year. And this will go on and on forever. Now we are in a society where even if we forget about the climate change story and the environmental constraint, we are in a society where the rate of growth is much smaller. And because of that, the youth generation doesn't have the same opportunities as the older generation. On top of that, we had the crisis. We are not sure that what we are living today is really the crisis or simply the fact that we have a slowdown in the rate of economic growth. We had the crisis in 2009. We know little about the causes of this crisis, but it is not this crisis which generated a slowdown in growth. So slowdown in growth is a kind of long-run process, and we have to live with that.
Però, professore, se diciamo un policy maker ha, allora se diciamo un primo policy maker dice è fondamentale la disuguaglianza del reddito.
Sorry. This is four, no? So I'm breaking everything.
Allora dicevo che se noi teoricamente un policy maker che accettasse come prevalente l'interpretazione che c'è una crisi e la disuguaglianza è fondamentale nel campo del reddito, potrebbe in teoria intervenire con una tassazione e con una forma di ridistribuzione. Se noi, come lei ha detto, e io penso che è prevalente la disuguaglianza delle opportunità, si ha come l'impressione che l'intervento di policy successivo abbia effetti molto più in là. Cioè, detta banalmente, se noi diciamo che sono i giovani i principali, le principali vittime, poi il risarcimento che diamo loro, ovvero più education, più mobilità sociale, è un risarcimento che ha una validità differita nel tempo, non è immediato. E quindi questo è un problema serio nella percezione poi dell'opinione pubblica. E mi aggancio. L'avvento della società digitale può riequilibrare in parte queste differenze? Non a caso noi usiamo un termine anglosassone, digital divide, che noi possiamo tradurre come anche disuguaglianza digitale. In teoria dovrebbe essere una disuguaglianza digitale che dovrebbe andare a compensare quella disuguaglianza dalla quale partiamo a favore delle generazioni più avanzate. Ma sarà davvero così? Cioè i giovani potranno usufruire della loro maggiore alfabetizzazione digitale per ridurre il gap? Non mi sono spiegato?
Okay, two remarks on what you just said. I mean, these are nice questions, important questions. The first thing is, what should be the population we are looking at when we are measuring inequality? Does it make sense in a society to compare people who are in their 50s who have most of their career behind them, who made money during their career, who own a house, who have some wealth, with people who are in their 20s, and didn't have all those opportunities of accumulating. Didn't have all these opportunities of accumulating not only wealth under the form of a house, but also human capital through their work, through their experience in a company. Somehow, inequality should be measured among people who are alike. And the kind of inequality that we are using, the kind of inequality measure that we are using when we are putting all the people together as something artificial. What we like to look at is what is the inequality within generations and whether this inequality within generations tend to increase when we move from one generation to another generation. When I'm referring to equalizing opportunities, I'm referring to the fact that by doing that, and especially when we talk about education, by doing that we'll be equalizing opportunities, income, and at the same time we'll be increasing the average level of income of the young generation. But you're right to say that this is something that will be seen when those people will be older, when these people will be in their 30s or in their 40s. Now, this may not be, this is something which is fundamentally different from looking at inequality in the whole population. Okay? This will have an impact progressively as those people will become, will represent a higher and higher proportion of the whole population, then more inequality in that, in those young generations progressively will become more equality in the whole population. Okay? Now, you are absolutely right to say that this is the long run. Maybe we would like to reduce inequality for other reasons in the short run, simply because we believe for other reasons, and this is the reason why I insisted at the beginning about the various philosophical attitudes toward inequality, we may want to reduce income inequality in the short run because this is something that we find inconvenient or immoral or unsatisfactory. But this is a different thing. Or we may want to reduce income inequality, this is my last slide, income inequality today, because we want to avoid income-rich people to transmit to their kids some inequality that comes with their wealth. So because of that, we may want to introduce to tax rich people, but if we do it with this kind of objective, this is again to reduce, to equalize opportunities, not to equalize income. Now, there is another issue that I think is worth to be stressing. It is the fact that we have, because of globalization, we have less and less power of taxation. Because people are mobile, if we increase too much the marginal income tax rate in a country, then it is likely that people, maybe people will not move, but they move their wealth. We just heard today that this big American company, Pfizer, which is producing Viagra in particular, will merge with another company which is located in Ireland. And because of that, Pfizer will benefit from the very favorable tax regime in Ireland. And doing that, a few billion dollars will simply be missing in the revenue of the United States. This kind of mobility is extremely important, and this means that the taxation power of every country is being reduced because of that. You may remember that when François Hollande became president and he decided that then the people earning more than 1 million euros would be taxed at 75%, several people decided to move from France, and among them Gérard Depardieu, the actor, decided to go to live in Russia. Okay, this is anecdotal, okay, and Depardieu is a funny character, and maybe we should consider that this is...
Poi non ci è andato.
This, okay, but this is something which is becoming extremely serious, and mean that it is difficult to, it is more and more difficult to distribute at the very top of the distribution. Now, some progress have been made. In Europe, for example, it is okay that, and between the United States and several other countries, there is now the rule such that anybody, any European citizen having an account, a banking account in a foreign country, the bank has to report to the tax authority of that citizen all the operations made on the account. This is not, this will not end with tax evasion, but this certainly will help giving back some autonomy to tax authorities in various countries. So we have to keep in mind those limits.
Io prenderei delle domande dalla platea, comincerei perché...
Grazie. Forse posso fare in francese...
Italiano.
Allora, grazie per l'intervento. Ero curiosa di sapere, dunque non sono un economista, però conosco un po' il lavoro di Thomas Piketty, che spiega le disuguaglianze attraverso i rapporti generazionali di trasmissione del patrimonio. Tutto bene? Sì. E mi domandavo se i vostri paradigmi sono molto diversi, ma se sono integrabili e come lei si pone rispetto a questo tipo di spiegazione.
Perfetto.
Grazie.
Prendiamo un'altra.
Raccogliamo due o tre domande, quindi chi ha alzato la mano? Qui ce n'è uno, qui da qui seconda fila.
Dunque, molti osservatori sul problema della disuguaglianza di redditi di cui lei ha accennato all'inizio della sua trattazione, dicono che dal punto di vista proprio sociale sembra che la middle class vada verso l'estinzione. Volevo sapere il suo punto di vista a proposito.
Un'altra? Posto? Qui davanti, professore.
Lei pensa che sia risolubile il problema che ha posto indipendentemente dall'assunzione in senso serio del principio di responsabilità da parte di ciascuno, che dovrebbe innanzitutto porsi il problema del rapporto tra ciò che ha ricevuto e ciò che ha dato? Questo vale sia con riferimento a chiunque, sia a chi appartiene alle vecchie generazioni, sia ove si pensi alle nuove generazioni, perché le nuove generazioni non sono partite, ad esempio, da dove sono partito io, ma sono partite dalle mie spalle.
E allora le tre domande gliele ricordo. La prima era su Piketty, l'estinzione del ceto medio, e l'ultima domanda l'ha ascoltata. Facciamo un po' di ping pong, un po' veloce su questo, per dare l'opportunità a più persone di porre delle ulteriori questioni.
Okay, on Piketty, I don't think that there is any big difference in what I have said and what Piketty says. One big difference is that Piketty is talking more about wealth inequality and the transmission of wealth. And from that point of view, when I am talking about social mobility, I was looking more at the transmission of income-generating power, but I could also have looked at the transmission of wealth. And the point made by Piketty is simply the fact that because the wealth is becoming more and more important with respect to income, we will see in the future, and maybe we are already seeing, and this is where the debate is about Piketty's book, we may already be seeing that wealth transmission is regaining importance that it had lost in the past. When we look today at what is the impact of wealth transmission in the transmission of inequality across generations, it is not something very important. Why? Simply because the importance of wealth with respect to income is rather low. But because we are living in a world where, according to Piketty, the rate of growth of the economy is lower than the rate of return to wealth, there will be more and more wealth in comparison with the level of income, and inheritance will become more and more important. This means that more and more inequality will appear through the inheritance process than it was the case before. Yes, I mean, this is quite possible. His point is to say that from that point of view, we are coming back to the old days, maybe to the beginning of the 20th century. This is possible. Whether this will happen or not depends very much on what will happen to the rate of return to wealth in the future, what will happen to the rate of growth in the future. So very much depends on his assumption that the rate of return will remain constant for the next two or three generations, and the rate of growth will remain constant for the next two or three generations. So this is really where the his point, and I don't think that I'm in disagreement with that, but I'm looking personally to what is going on today, what we can say today with the kind of data that that we have. On the polarization, is the middle class disappearing? It is very difficult to define what the middle class is. If you'd say that the middle class is the middle of the income distribution, saying that the middle class is disappearing would be to say that there is a kind of polarization in the economy, having more and more very rich people and more very poor people. We don't observe that. We observe that the income distribution in our society is moving toward more inequality. At least this was the case in some societies up to some point. I mean, I think that we should be, and the one of the charts I've shown in the case of Europe shows very well that inequality is not increasing everywhere. It has been increasing in the past, and in many countries over the last 5 or 10 years, it is more or less stable, so we don't observe anything like that. Now, you may say that the middle class is something else. The middle class is really the pivotal voter, the people who are important in making public decisions go in one direction or another, which means this is not exactly the middle of the distribution, but it is somewhere around the middle of the top half of the distribution. In that case, maybe there is some kind of redistribution from those people to the very top, but this is something which is very marginal. So except if you define the middle class in a way that is completely different from if you define the middle class without any reference to income, then I don't think that this point about the disappearance of the middle class is correct. Okay, maybe we should make a distinction between when we look at earnings and when we look at income. Earnings mean the wages or the earnings obtained by people who are working. So this would be the distribution of individual earners, individual workers. Then in some countries, it would seem that today, at the beginning, at some stage, the bottom of the distribution was very hurt, possibly through the competition with Asian countries, I mean with globalization and the competition with Asian countries. Now today, some people say that it is the middle of the scale that is being affected by the competition with emerging countries. There is a debate about this. This seems to be the case in the UK. It does not seem to be the case in other countries. So I don't think that this point is really important. And about the last point about, again, generations, and your point about to say that we should give as much as we received, then, I mean, this is, I'm not sure about the way to interpret this statement. You can interpret this statement as going against redistribution, saying, okay, in the public, in the way in which the public sector functions, you would like to people to get from the government in terms of public goods, public services, as much as what they gave through taxation. But of course, this goes against the issue, the notion of a progressive redistribution. Now, when you talk about young people versus older people, and the fact that young people may have advantages that older people don't have, yes, this is possible. As I said before, the problem is, what is our reference when we talk about inequality? Are we talking about the whole society, merging, combining all possible age groups, or are we looking at generations? Or are we looking at inequality only across generations? We don't care about the inequality within generations. We are looking at the fact that one generation did better than another generation. These are completely different concepts of inequality, and it is quite possible that those various concepts evolve in completely opposite direction. It is conceivable that inequality across generations may increase at the same time as inequality within generation tends to be reduced. It is quite possible. Now, in order to make a statement about whether this is good, whether this is bad, you see that you need value judgments about the way in which you compare inequality across generations and within generations. And as we are talking about inequality across generations, the issue of the environment is, of course, something which is absolutely crucial. What, when we talk about the environment and the problem of global warming and the conference that will start in Paris in a few days, we are really talking about future generations and making sure that those future generations will not be too much hurt by what this generation is doing.
Grazie, credo che abbiamo finito il tempo a nostra disposizione, quindi ringraziamo moltissimo il pubblico di Segnavie, ringraziamo il professor Bourguignon, Dario Di Vico, grazie per essere tornato a trovarci a Padova. Prossimo appuntamento di Segnavie, 26 gennaio, Hans Joas, i diritti umani sono un'esclusiva occidentale. Rimanete in contatto con noi sulla pagina www.segnavie.it anche per rivedere dalla prossima settimana questa conferenza per rimanere aggiornati sui prossimi appuntamenti. Grazie e buonasera.